Welcome to the YouTube channel for Bible Biker Church in Rockwood, Tennessee. I am Fred Marshall, Elder and Associate Pastor. We pray that what you're about to see is inspiring to you as it is the truth in the Word of God, as it is written. We pray that it blesses you and anyone that you share it with. If you like what you see, please click on the like button and subscribe to our channel. Also know that you can find us on Facebook under the page name Bible Biker Church. Thanks and have a blessed day. All right, good morning, Bible Biker Church. How's a few of us doing this morning?
We're doing fine.
As you can tell, we have a bunch of people out today, a lot of people sick. Appreciate you guys coming. We just have... I don't know what I'm trying to say. Just a heart for God, I know. But we have people that are ill, so we're going to be praying for them today. Okay? But, so we can get started? Yes, sir? No, it is not
sick, too.
Okay. All right. So those that are here, if you can, stand with me. Let's sing praises to our God and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Finding myself at a loss for words, and the funny thing is, it's okay. The last thing I need is for you to be heard. What you would say, Word of God speak, would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know you're in
concept to many, but for those of us who speak professionally, that's hard. But to get in front of God and know that He is with you, that's exactly what happens. It is very humbling. Now, I don't talk to Will about what his sermon is for the day, and I don't really pay attention to what's going on in the news or on the weather or whatever in the morning. But isn't that funny? It's raining outside now. It wasn't when I put that song in this morning. And it goes right along with what we were talking about here earlier today. I just praise God that that happens over and over again. Yeah, imagine me at a loss for words. It doesn't happen, okay.
From the highest of heights to the depths of the
Hey, listen, today's the day we're going to be ordering the tickets for the men's conference Iron Sharpens Iron. I've got four names on that list, and we'll be ordering those tickets today. If you want to know more about it and you're considering going, just let me know today. Church is paying for it, but we're doing this to get the discount. It is Saturday, March 2nd, all day. We'll be leaving here at 6 o'clock in the morning, driving to Chattanooga, and it's over at 5:30, so we won't be home until about 7 o'clock. Right? So it's an all-day thing, March 2nd, Saturday. That happens to be the day before my birthday. Not that that matters, but I'm just saying. Other things going on. Let me remind you that back there to the left of the sound booth by the coffee pots on the side of the wall there is the prayer ammunition box, the spiritual ammunition box, we call it. It's for prayer requests and anything that you want to give back to God. Notice we don't pass the plate here, and Will and I don't take any pay or anything like that. That's just to keep the ministry running. So anything you have to put in there, please put it back there in that box. All the prayer requests are prayed over by the prayer team. These guys get emails from me during the week about what's going on. Speaking of which, not only do we have the spiritual ammunition box there, but we also have a Facebook page and a YouTube page. And we got a request in last night on the Facebook page for a person that has cancer in hospice care. So it works. Our message is getting out there. In addition to that, you guys that were here last week saw Michael Summers. He got here late, but still he had a powerful testimony. He wants you to know how thankful he is that you guys accepted him the way he is, and is accepting his ministry, and the church helped out that ministry the best that we could. When Mom and I took him home Sunday, we took a bucket full of food, and he said that'll feed a lot of people. He feeds homeless people out of his trailer. So it's amazing what he's doing. He doesn't have anything, he can't do anything, but yet his heart is in the right place. He's part of the Christian Outlaw, what's that word for, charity club. And he's just loving what he's doing. So he wants to thank you again for being kind to him and keep praying for him. We have a lot of people out sick today. We'll talk about that. We have just a lot of families with different kinds of things, whether it be stomach viruses or flu or whatever. So it's kind of sparse in here today. That's why. So be in prayer for the ones that you don't see. And also be in prayer for the ministries that we continue to try to get out there and do things. Another thing that's happening, Satan is attacking us constantly. You guys need to know that. We can tell you story after story, but it doesn't matter because we're doing God's will and He's protecting us. We've been contacted by another leader in the community that wants to work with us and work with other churches. We'll have more information about that, I guess, next week. Will may say something more about it. He knows more about it than I do. But just know that there are people now that are looking to us going, there's something about this place. Because we teach the truth, and we teach the love of God true, but we also actually care about the community. We've had more people contact us about food pantry. We're constantly getting requests in for all kinds of things. So just know that God's work is being done. And I appreciate all of you that are helping out. I really, really do. You'll never know how much of that. Anything else, Brother Will, that I forgot? No. Okay. All right, then let me open us up with a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord God, again, we thank you for this place that you've given us the opportunity to stand in here. And Lord, just listen to your word as Brother Will brings the message. Father God, be with him. Put your words in his mouth. Father, we just are just humbled and awed by everything that you're doing through this place. Father God, we ask you to be with those that couldn't be here today. Put your hands of healing around those that are sick, Lord. Also for those that are working or couldn't make it for any other reason, Lord, just bring them back in your time. And Father God, as always, we thank you for what you're doing to us, through us, and for us in this place. And in Jesus' holy and precious name, all of God's people said,
Amen.
No doubt. If y'all stand with me for if you can, one more song, and we'll go from there.
One day in heaven was filled with his One day when sin was as black as could be, Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin, dwelt among men, my example is he. Word became flesh, the light shined among us, his glory revealed. Living he loved me, dying he saved me, buried he carried me, my sins far away. Rising he justified, freely forever. One day he's come.
That you'll find interesting. Remember a few minutes ago I said I never know what Will's going to talk about? Wow, I got goosebumps because of what Will's going to be talking about today that he told me after he got here, after I'd already set this up. So it's always fun to see how that happens. Just remember this, all things that are done in the will of God work together for good. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Here we go.
Lord, you are God's will.
At our church, Jesus is Lord. That single belief calls us together as a community and sends us into our world with hope and purpose. And our dark past will never define the future. There's always redemption, which means there's always a brighter day. At our church, we don't think we're better than any other church out there. We're just doing our best to become our best. At our church, we want you to believe in God, but we also want you to know that God believes in you. We are not against people who don't attend church anywhere. Instead, we pursue them with love, the very same love that's pursuing us. At our church, we're learning to serve God with all our hearts, and we're learning to worship Him with all our lives. And if you're looking for the perfect church, we're not it. At our church, we will make mistakes, but we will choose to grow with them. At our church, we're part of a global community that's knit together by the resurrection of Jesus. And by the way, at our church, we believe that really happened too. At our church, we will engage with people who are in real need because we are the hands and the feet of Christ. And finally, we need you to hear this loud and clear. At our church, it's not really our church at all. It's His. And we live and move and breathe in His church for His glory and His fame, not ours.
Right.
So here's the invitation. You're invited to jump in with your whole heart at your own pace and to experience the life that awaits you in Christ. Friends, this is going to be good. Welcome to our church.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Well, as we said before, we've got some people that are out sick today. We've got quite a few that are out sick today. And the thing about that is, this morning I got up and, started getting a lot of texts. And we also heard that, Brother Tim wasn't going to be here because of one of his children being sick. But when you get the text and you get the information from people about how they're not going to be here and everything, it just makes you think, they took the time to text me and everything, which means to me that they'd love to be here, that they want to be here, but they just can't. Sometimes, when someone is sick, it's best that they don't come around a big crowd, but I would say church would be safe to do that because, everything that we operate is under God's will. We always joke, Brother Fred and I, I always tell people I'm God's will because everybody calls me Will and I belong to God. So, but I don't mean that in any kind of disrespectful way. I just mean that I do belong to God. I was sitting here earlier when Brother Fred asked if we had any other announcements, and something came on my mind while I was sitting there that I thought would be important to talk about. We have been blessed as a ministry, and if you ever heard about how I was able to get the motorcycle that I have, was a true blessing from God because it's something that I can take trips on now. I've always had things that were not very comfortable to ride that I couldn't be on for a very long period of time, especially now that I'm getting older, my bones are getting sore, and I got a lot of issues going on. And it was just, I knew that the only way that I was able to get that was a blessing of God to put me in the ministry that I'm in. And with that being said, we've also had three more people within the last 2 weeks that have been blessed by God for this ministry that has something that we can get out and travel on to our ministry. God is making a way for us.
Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
And if anybody out there doesn't believe that, just watch and see what we do. Through God. Just watch. Brother Fred had talked about people are starting to reach out to us as a ministry from other ministries. They're wanting for us to be a part of what they do because of our testimonies that we have and our past experience. Brother James has dealt with you go right across from the co-op, there's a car lot there, and Brother James has dealt with them, and he told me this past week he was coming home from being blessed with something that God blessed him with this week. But anyway, he was coming home and got a phone call from the guy that owns the place and told him that, you know, he needed Brother James to stop by. He said it wasn't a business call, it was something else. Well, us in the ministry, it ended up being a business call for us, because what they're trying to start is an outreach for people that have drug-related problems, this hooked on drugs, that are is trying to better themselves. And because of Brother James sharing word with who he dealt with, we're going to set up a meeting to go over there and talk with him, because he wants us to be involved in what he has going on. So see, the community's starting to come together and see the need for people that are willing to get out there and work in the community to be part of what's going on. We got into our food pantry last week and when Brother Fred said a bucket, this was one of them big containers. It was about that wide, trying to hold it. It took two of us to tote it out there. And not bragging on what we were able to do, what I am saying, though, is if you look at our food pantry, it looks like nobody even took anything out of it. Awesome. Now, we have some people in here that are just going above and beyond to make sure that we have things here to help others with. And I'm not going to steal their blessing from them. I'm going to let them get that from God. But I'm just saying, please keep up the good work, because you cannot outgive God. And reason saying, fill up a big container like that full of stuff and get out there and then go back to look at it, and you're like, well, you didn't give them enough. Because there's still plenty in there. But the thing is, you know, our account, we talk about our spiritual ammunition box. We don't keep money saved in our account. We have money in there. When people ask for help, we give them help. Because it's not our money, it's God's money. And for someone to come to us as a ministry to ask for help for things, God led them to do that. So every time we take out, we turn around the next time something comes up and discuss what we can do to help someone that needs help. It seems like there's the same amount in there. It's always more than what the person needs or more than what they're asking for. And I'm kind of, you know, you kind of think, how is it that we're not taking anything out of there when we're taking out of there all the time? It just goes right back to you can't outgive God. Brother Kevin will tell you right out, I mean, he's very passionate about that. You cannot outgive God. Amen. And we're finding that out. And we're finding out that people are taking notice of things going on in the community where they need help, and we're being called to help. And as a ministry, that's a blessing, because minister means to attend to other people's needs. So that's one thing that we have going on for us. And another thing that comes to my mind is I need to announce that we've got a new bar and grill that just opened up right down the road.
Cadillac.
I mean, yeah. Was it two blocks away?
Three, yeah.
It's called the Cadillac Grill. Where most churches would find that to be offensive for a place like that to open up near a church, I thank God that within the community, He's putting our ministry work within three blocks away from us. We don't have to travel far to go out and do God's work. See, where other people would see that as being offensive of things that go on in a place like that, I see now that we can get together and drop of a hat and say, okay, let's go right here. It's right here close to the church. Let's go right down here, see who's in there, and talk to them about God. That's another blessing for us. We went to another place right up on top of the mountain there. It's that, was it Mountaintop Bar and Grill?
Yeah.
So we went up there. I mean, very good place to eat. They got birds that'll fly right in there and sit right at your table with you if you ain't careful. But But the thing is, I mean, there's so many places around here that, you know, most Christians would not go to, that we go in there and we're accepted going in there for what we do in Christ, and we're able to actually sit and talk with people about what God's doing for us. And it'll go right along in with this message that we're given today. So sometimes when we think that things are being put up that will be disrespectful towards Christians and disrespectful towards God, look at it as work that God's blessing you with. We don't have to travel all the way to Knoxville. We don't have to travel all the way to Chattanooga. We don't have to travel to places like that to find people that need to be ministered to. We have it right here. We can do our mission trip right here in town. So there's always a godly way of looking at things when it comes up. It's not a curse, it's a blessing.
Like shining a bright flashlight in a dark closet.
Yep, and that's exactly what the message today is about being the light. And it's amazing. We started off in Sunday school this morning, and one of the things that Sister Darla and Brother Kevin had highlighted to read and read in here was John chapter 1, and they started in verse 10. Well, my message today was John chapter 1, and I have it highlighted from verse 1 all the way down to verse 9. So, how amazing is that? I mean, it's just things like that that just keep coming up, let you know you're just right on the right track. We'll start off with John chapter 1, verse 1. It says, "In the beginning was the Word," Word being capitalized. We all know what that means. We all know what the Word is. We all know who the Word is. That's Jesus. That's God. It says, "The Word was God," or "the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by Him, and without Him was not anything made that was made. In Him was life, and the life was the light of men. And the light shineth in darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not." Now see, let's talk about that comprehend in the King James Version, and look right here in the ESV, and it says, "The darkness has not overcome it." Now, if you'll look that up too, in the there's an easy read version that you can look up, and it says, "The darkness has not defeated it." Because darkness cannot defeat light. It may have shadows in the light. So what we do with that is just make the light brighter. Overcome the shadow. Anywhere you shine that light, it overcomes darkness. Darkness cannot overcome light. That's even, you know, at night when it's dark and the moon's out, there's still light that comes from the moon in the darkness. It says in verse 6, "There was a man sent from God whose name was John. The same came for a witness, to bear witness of the light, that all men through him might believe." And it says might believe because we're not forced to believe. God gives us that choice. And that's where our faith comes from, in believing. But it doesn't say that every man or woman will believe. But where that might falls in there, it's where that light from us could also fall in there. To think about places right down the road that are opening up to sell alcohol and things like that. We've already talked about, you know, on Sundays when we go out, the best place for us to go eat is Bar and Grill. Most Christians won't go in there. We don't have to wait on a table. We don't have to wait in line. We don't get a thing that says, "Oh, there's about a 45-minute wait." They open the door and say, "Come on in. We got a table right here for you to sit at." And you know they're not all heathens in there either, because when we pray for the meal, if they're walking up with anything, they stand there and let's get done with our prayer, and they see what we're in there doing. We ain't been kicked out of one yet. It's kind of nice, ain't it?
Mm-hmm.
So that through him might believe. And if we are the light, we can reach a whole lot more people that will believe if we're out there doing what God called us to do. John was not that light. It says here in verse 8, he was not the light, but was sent to bear witness of that light. That was the true light, which lighteth every man that cometh into the world. We're talking about Jesus. We talked about in Sunday school today. We had an open discussion about things, and we talked about, you know, what's going on with the new laws and everything in New York about being able to do the abortions the way that they're doing. Let's trace that all the way back to where, if you read God's word, it talks about, you know, people that worship other gods that sacrifice their own children. So what are these people that are doing that, these abortions, what are they doing? They're obviously worshiping another god. It's just like what we've talked about the times that we're living in and the things that are going on. Because we talk about, and as Christians, we already know that, you know, when Mary entered the room with Jesus as a fetus in her belly, John leapt in his mother's womb. He knew that the Son of God was in that room as a fetus inside of his mother. People don't get that. People don't understand that when they're out killing. And that's what it is killing. It's murder.
Exactly.
And we're not going to get into a political debate or anything like that over what's going on in the world, but that's a caution for us Christians to know that if they'll kill them at full term, the only thing they have left to do after that is kill them after they're born if they don't want them. Mm-hmm. And the only thing that we could say to that is, when we look at things like that, it's a convenience of someone's life to not have to be tied down with something that should be considered a blessing from God.
Amen.
Regardless of things that we all have a past. You know, that baby could come into the world already with some type of past that affects the mother. It's up to that mother to show that baby love. Some people say, well, what about a constant reminder? A constant reminder. Something bad happened to this person, but showed her that she could still love someone else and be blessed with a child. You know, that's as far as I need to go with that. God lets me know when it's time to be quiet about something. But the thing is, about that light that we're supposed to be, you think about the light when we go out to places and we'll go out to do things. If these other ministries did not see us as a light, or if we were not living our life as a light and telling other people the word of God like we're supposed to, they wouldn't be calling on us. They wouldn't be asking us to join up with them to do things. They would not be looking for us for the help that they need. You know, a lot of times we hear that song, I Saw the Light. You know, sometimes when you see that light, it's a way of getting yourself out of the bind that you're in. It's to see the light at the end of the tunnel, is a term a lot of people use. Tunnels are dark. But you see that light at the end of the tunnel, lets you know where you need to go, what you need to go towards, what you need to head towards. The best way we can consider ourselves to be that light at the end of the tunnel at all times is the way we live, the example that we set. The biggest way to have the light to shine to others is to have a relationship with God. We talked about people that will be the first ones to put us out of their lives. for being a Christian and standing up for our Christian principles of what we're taught. We've had people that were kicked out of their best friend's house, people that are constantly being unfriended on social media because of their stand on the Word of God. But you think about in the future, who's the first person that's going to be called on when that person runs into problems, sicknesses, something that's going to lead to death for them? They're might going to say, oh, time to be friends with that person I unfriended because they can get me where I need to be. You know, the light that we go out and shine to others is something that we want it to burn in a way that would draw others in, like a moth to a flame. We always hear that saying. And you think about if you're not setting the example that God would have you set, and you go out and try to be a light, you know, we're all gonna make mistakes. We're all gonna fall short. But we talked about this morning falling into that same routine day after day after day and trying to break that routine. To be that type of light to me would make me think about Cheryl and I would go down to pick my daughter up from work in Spring City. And on the way there, about halfway between Rockwood and Spring City, there's an old building that does auctions there. And one of the lights on the side of that thing, they got this one bright light on this side, and on the other side, it just flashes like a strobe light going down the road. And that's, we just don't want to look in that direction. You know, it's like you're going to have a seizure or something if you look at it. But think about someone who's supposed to be going out into the world as a light that only shines that light when they're wanting people to know that they know God. And then any other time, that light's not shining. It's kind of like a strobe light. Ain't nobody going to want to come around that because it's a put-off. In the society that we deal with, people are going to want to see us fail so that they can say, I told you so. But then other ones are going to want to see if we are really who we say that we are, because we are in an environment of people that do not trust. It takes a lot for us to try to build up trust in other people because of our backgrounds. I mean, everybody in the world has had someone try to destroy their trust. But we can't let that cause us to just go out and be a light when we're feeling good about ourselves, and then any other time, we're sitting right there in the crowd doing what everybody else does. I read a little little note, a piece of candy that Cheryl gave me. It says, be the person you look up to. If we look up to God, we are supposed to go out and be Christ-like. But to go out and take that light to other people is exactly what the example was set before us. Now you think about all the different types of light in the world. And you think sometimes, you know, them fluorescent lights, you'll see them when they go to come on. They'll flash like that and they'll finally come on. You know, sometimes we're living in a time where, you know, it takes a lot to get some of us started sometimes because we're going through those trials. But even though we're going through a trial, we still have the responsibility of being the light for someone else. Because the biggest thing the devil would want someone to see in us is defeat. And we can't show that defeat when we're out dealing with others. We can't go out and be fake. But we can still have people see in us that we might be going through a hard time, but the light of God still shines in us. The best way to have that light continue to shine in you, even in those darkest times, is to continue to have a relationship with God. Someone told me that it takes God a long time to answer their prayers. Well, there's a lot of things that go on with prayers. Sometimes we pray for things that we don't need, and God knows we don't need it. Sometimes we pray for things that we feel like don't get answered in the time that we'd like to have them answered. But sometimes when we go to God, it's like we're having to rebuild a relationship with God, because we stayed away from Him for so long that here we are, like, back to that introductory phase, but not feeling that comfortable with God. If we keep that close personal relationship with God at all times, with everything that's going on in our life, it's not that hard for us to go to Him and ask Him for things, and it's not that hard to understand why He does or doesn't answer our prayers in the time we want it answered. Because I have caught myself in prayer knowing that it's not something that I need, knowing that it's something that will probably take me away from going out and being the light to the other world. It's like, you know, nice bass boat or something like that. Can't do a whole lot of preaching out there when you're talking to a bass. But, you know, everybody's entitled to their time, you know, as long as you're doing what you're supposed to be doing. But see, that's the thing, you know, to pray for something like that, not even have a place to park it, not even have time to use it, or have something like that pull you away from the time you're supposed to be spending doing your work for God. You know, there's a whole lot of things out there that we'd like to have that we don't need. And we get confused with God when we pray for things and we don't receive it and think, well, God don't even hear me. No, God's just tired of you asking for stuff you don't need sometimes, you know. You have to be close enough to God to understand what it is we need as a ministry, as a worker for God. But everything that God blesses us with is meant to be a tool, to be used for that purpose. So we talk about being the light a lot in here, but it's something that we cannot overstress. It's something that we need to keep repeating so that we all understand that we don't get too comfortable just sitting back watching others go out and be the light. We go out and join that. You know, somebody goes sees Christians going out fellowshipping with each other and having a good time, they can understand that when they come to God, their life's not over. They don't have to quit doing things that they consider fun. Can a Christian go out and dance with their wife and do things like that? Well, yeah, they can. Can a Christian go out and sit in a bar and talk with other people and fellowship inside of a bar? Yes, they can. Jesus said we could. Read about how the Pharisees said that we shouldn't, and read about what Jesus said. So, you know, I always heard growing up about things about, you know, people going by and say, well, I seen that preacher going into a bar the other day. If you pay attention to where I go, you'd be able to go and say that you see me going to a bar too. Come on in and help me. Come on in and join me. I save you a seat. There's a lot of us that go into places like that. And one thing that Brother Fred and I will always tell you, we've seen salvation in those bars. Mm-hmm. Seen it happen. So by all means, Lord, send us all the work that we can handle. Because we need to get out there and do it. We need to go out there and be that light. Brother Fred, would you like to dismiss us in prayer?
I will. Heavenly Father, Lord God, again, we thank you for the word that you gave us. Father, John 1:1 says, in the beginning was the word, and we know that that word was your Son, our Savior, Jesus. Just as it says in Genesis, in the beginning, so is it in the beginning with you. Father, you've told us that we should be the light to the world, to imitate your Son, who is the light of the world. Father, give us that strength as we go out and we do that every day. Father, thank you for bringing us together for this corporate time of worship, but Lord, just be with us as we do this during the day as well, when we're not with each other. But Lord, let us pray for each other. Let us hold each other up. Lord, and we ask that you be with us as we do that. Father God, we ask you for your hands of protection around us until we come back again. In your holy and precious name we pray. Amen.
Amen. With this point of our message, if as we're all getting ready to fellowship and go get something to eat. If there, Brother Gene's not here with us today, we've got plenty of people that could fill in. If there's anybody that needs prayer today, would like to come up and have prayer over anything, you know, this altar's open. If there's anybody that needs to come up and talk, that's one of the things about us coming in where we say iron sharpens iron. If you're ever in here and God puts it on your heart that you need to be up here and you need counseling, you need prayer, or anything like that, it's not disruptive to follow your heart when it comes to God. So if there's anybody out there today that needs prayer or that just needs to talk about something that's on their heart, we're up here and we can help you through that. All you have to do is ask. Mm-hmm. And that's all I have, other than figure out what we're going to eat at today.